Good evening, everybody. First of all, welcome to the beautiful University of ICM. My name is Rimantė, and welcome you all here to the first seminar of Enterprise Lithuania and Startup Lithuania. What is a startup? Yay. Some information for you. This one is the first seminar of the whole program of the year. Every month you will be able to participate in a free of charge seminar which will be connected to startups on one or another topic. And here you can see the internet page which we have for startups. So everything what is connected to startups is available here. Also on this website you can find all the information about the upcoming events. So I wish you a pleasant evening, and first presenter tonight is Eddie, a founder of the beautiful startup TrackDuck.
Hello. Hello, how's everybody?
Good.
It's a pleasure to be back here, had the privilege to be one of the students here and cheat on exams here and everything. Good stuff. And I'm happy to come back and share my knowledge about startups now with you guys. So, let's get this started. For starters, I've seen a lot of startup people here already. So can all the startupers who have a startup or they think they have a startup put their hands up now for Vilnius? Yay! What the hell are you doing here, people? It's like a middle of a working day. Why are you here wasting your time?
Working.
Good answer, Claudio. The rest of the people, students? Only five students here. Everyone else is like working professionals. So students? Like, okay, only the middle rows. Okay, and who are the other people? Sir in the front, who are you? What do you do? Yes. All right, good to have you here. It's always a pleasure to meet software engineers because we're in lack of them. So software engineers? Okay, four, five, and six. Designers? One. We're in lack of designers, apparently. Why I'm here? Because I want to clarify this very complicated subject of a startup. It's really a mess of information right now for someone who's first time in this wonderful ecosystem or community or movement. And there is a lot of buzz and there's a lot of hype about the startup kids. There's even a bunch of movies now about how youngsters in their 19 or 20 years old in their garage or in their parents' houses start the companies and become billionaires. It's not always like that. Actually, it's very, very rarely that it happens like that. And because of all the media attention to this, we have a big confusion. What is a startup? How do you go around starting one and how it works? Shortly about me and why I think I am qualified to talk about this. So currently I am a CEO and co-founder of TrackDuck. I've been one for 10 or 11 months right now, 10, 11. Since inception of TrackDuck, we have won a number of events, including Garage 48 Hackathon, Login Startup Pitching Competition, Yandex Start Competition in Minsk, Belarus. We went through Startup Sauna Acceleration Program in Finland. We went to Silicon Valley, selected as one of the top startups in Startup Sauna. We got a small investment in Finland, then a bunch of other competitions, events. Also, we were part of Elevator Fund program in Israel for a while. And finally, we went through a whole Lithuanian startup roadshow where we're selected among top 17 startups. But this is just past 10 months. By the way, we just launched yesterday our full version of TrackDuck in trackduck.com, so please go check it out if you haven't yet. Yay, thank you, Justas. So right now it's for free because I haven't finished integrating payments, so enjoy. Otherwise, in the past, I've also had other startups. Probably the most fun for me was Gig Basket, with which we won a grant to go to Silicon Valley. It's one of my Silicon Valley trips. We went through sort of monthly acceleration program for 2 months, and then some additional time. I worked for other startups as a marketeer or salesperson. I have helped out HUD Vilnius co-working space here in Vilnius. I have worked on Start Karma, which is educational program for startups, and I had the luck to work briefly for Startup Highway, also as promoter and marketeer. So more or less for past 3 years, I've been deeply full-time involved with startups in different countries of different people. And even before that, I was working as a freelancer on different web projects. And while studying here in ISM and then Edinburgh Napier University, I actually finished my bachelor thesis in internet marketing in China, which is more or less about startups from the United States going into China. So I claim I have a position here and a point of view to share with you. From now, the boring part is kind of over. So whenever you feel like you have a question, please put up your hand and let's like have a discussion if something is not clear. And if you're too shy, shoot me a Twitter or email. I prefer Twitter because I think this should be a public discussion. And I'll come back to you straight after the end. So firstly, startups are cool. And it looks for me like everyone wants to be a startup, even if they're not a startup. And that's wrong. Because just like in animal kingdom, there's different kinds of animals. So if a startup is a business, it doesn't mean that your business is a startup, if that makes sense. So if you're a horse, you're not a pig, right? Why people want to be a startup? That's really actually still a mystery to me, because startup for me associated with failure, lots of efforts, and very usually little or no return on failure. Anyways, but if we look at the broad perspective, startup was adopted widely by public, by media, in the year of 2000, exactly. I think from October, then the dot-com bubble started happening. So, smart ISM students and everyone else, who knows what was dot-com bubble? Please, sir, with a gray jacket, let's share that. Yes?
There was a bubble. Maybe I will not go into explain what does it mean.
Just
bubble
one was, sentence.
It was an explosion probably of high expectations and earnings in IT sector, probably.
I could not put it better. There was so high expectations that in a bit less than 10, more like 5-6 years, there was so much money put into so-called startups, upcoming internet companies, who had no business model, no revenue whatsoever, no sales. They basically people, there would be a group of people who gathered together, buy a domain, call themselves pet.com, and they would raise hundreds and hundreds of millions of dollars. This had to end because it was, of course, not a sustainable way to do business. So in the year 2000, I think it says, March, it's not October. In March, the first company failed, and then people saw in a stock exchange, investors saw that there is nothing behind these companies. It's just a domain, a bunch of people, there is no business model, no customers, no revenues. And everything started crashing down. And you can see some numbers, but probably the most amazing point that I think the stock market, NASDAQ, hasn't still came up to the level that it was in the year 2000. So huge losses, equivalent to the Russian crisis or, a small part of our financial crisis we had in 2008. But after this dot-com bubble, technology keep developing, and then we have these super, super successful companies like Google and Facebook. And because they're, I really like the term super unicorns. It basically means a company, unicorns are companies in Silicon Valley who come over $1 billion of valuation. Now, Facebook, Google, and others became super unicorns, and they got so much media attention and so much popularity that it was hard to wrap your head around it. And suddenly everyone wants to be a startup, everyone wants to own a startup for some reason, even if you're owning a kebab shop or something. And that's where really the startup hit the fan and spread everywhere in the world, and we got some pieces in Lithuania too, I think in late 2007, 2008, that's where the startup ecosystem, in my point of view, started in Lithuania. So one thing that it has, this all has in common is Silicon Valley, where all these companies started. So numbers. Oh, I already said that it's next to San Francisco, and I'm gonna ask where it is. Okay, so not where it is, but what is the Silicon Valley? No more smart people. Okay, well, it's an area actually just about the same size and length as from Vilnius to Klaipeda. It's a valley, kind of, and it has the name Silicon Valley because initially it was where all the silicon chip companies started. So we're talking about Intel, HP, et cetera, who later moved to other parts of the businesses. And due to spin-offs, due to development, due to a number of reasons, this valley became so successful in technology. It is number one in patents. It's number one of millionaires and billionaires per square kilometer in the world. It's number one in innovation in any kind of field, going from internet to biotechnology to infotechnology to whatever. This is the Silicon Valley, from San Francisco to more or less San Jose in the bottom and around. So when you're talking about startup, we're talking about specific companies, the very specific challenges. And nowadays, we have these companies who are outside Silicon Valley, outside the United States, even here in Lithuania, and I guess we're going to have one talking afterwards with me. But it is not a kebab shop, right? We're referring to specific industry and specific problems. So let's look at these specific problems. Well, firstly, it starts off looking as any average business. So these 3 points are taken from Dave McClure, a famous investor and a startuper. Basically says, a startup is a business that's not sure what its product is, who are the customers, and how they're gonna make money in general. So this sounds pretty broad, and it's applicable to all businesses who are starting up anywhere in the world. Where it gets tricky is that startups are specifically designed, composed, people gathered together to do a startup to find a repeatable and scalable business model. And here, the underlining the emphasis, the two most important words are repeatable and scalable. Of course, there's a lot of different things that you heard about startups and software or some other words or buzzwords, etc. But I'm gonna look at those because for me, they really define what a startup is. And this is, by the way, is from Steve Blank's startup definition, adopted most widely according also to Wikipedia, etc. So, what does scalability and repeatability means? It means really growth or traction in startup terms. Traction literally means growth of your users, clients, downloads, whatever you're trying to get online. And once you're trying to get traction, what you're really looking for when you're trying to get growth, traction, yeah, you're looking for this infamous hockey stick, which you have on the left. Hockey stick refers to a line which represents the amount of users growing rapidly, basically starting low and showing or usually showing the investment or something like that, starting low, and then suddenly shooting up and forming something like a hockey stick. Reality, usually this doesn't happen. 90-something percent of startups fail in first half a year. So why are the reasons? Well, firstly, they fail to find a business model because, and a lot of people in the startup world refer this to monetization. Because what happens, startups build some kind of product that they think is going to solve the problem of the world, but then they fail to actually sell it, they fail to monetize it, they fail to get money for it. Is this clear by far, by the way? It's getting very silent and constrained. Yes? All right. So they fail to find a business model. How are they going to actually create, deliver, and capture value? That means sell, get revenue, and go back home with bags of cash. Then even if they find a business model, they fail to grow it. They fail to find traction, and they fail to scale it. Scaling meaning being able to take care of the huge rapid growth of users, of interactions in your website, of a demand for your business. In a simple terms, one of the challenges of scalability is simply these boxes represent servers that suddenly, because you have geometric growth of your users, you need so much more servers. Like you're doubling them every day or month or whatever is the growth of your startup. So, and then you have to choose how you're gonna do it, because usually this is very hard technologically. Well, at least used to be in the past before cloud computing. Now it's getting easier and easier. So we come to these very specific challenges that are not, for example, so directly applied to restaurant business. So it's great to have a restaurant and you can grow them. You can become the McDonald's or whatever of the world, but you will not have a challenge of growing your business 100 or 1,000 or million times in the same year, which happens with startups. And this is really what startupers, investors, advisors, etc. are looking from a startup. So when you talk about this kind of growth and this kind of scalability and repeatability, you're really talking about high IT companies. Most oftenly, and well, at least in the past few years, has been internet startups, because you can easily spread your product, sell it online. You get users online very, very easily, very, very quickly. And because of this, then you face different challenges, that you have to win the best talent, and which is hard to find in technology business, right? You have to fight different privacy, sales difficulties that challenge your growth. You have to find capital to fund this scalability of your product and your company, because you need to hire these people, you need to buy these servers, which are usually very, very expensive. And then later on, maybe your company will face a crisis of creativity, and you will stop innovating, and your company will be eaten up by other startups or whatever. So how does it all start? Well, usually it's co-founders with little or no capital, usually because nowadays everyone wants to have a startup, so usually it's younger people who haven't earned any money, don't have any savings, and it really looks funny when you have a bunch of guys. Not everyone is getting this good. As I was thinking about, should I put this in? So what they do in a startup terms, it's called bootstrapping. There is many different ways to explain it, but it's basically not taking investment. And in the real world, this bootstrapping thing looks like this. You eat shit and live with your parents until you raise some money or start getting revenue, and then you can move out and start shopping normal food. Usually these people, these co-founders, gather together to solve a global problem and change the world and be the Larry Pages and Zuckerbergs of the world. So for example, my favorite startupper is Elon Musk. And this is what? This car is what? Tesla. And what is it? Why is it special? Yes, it's electric car. It's a global huge problem where we have our energy is based on coal and oil, and the more we move our needs from these non-recurable energy sources, the better it is. So we have Teslas, we're doing great. I love Elon Musk. So let's put. But sadly, usually startups fail to find a solution for many different reasons. But actually, the most often one is that simply the group, which is just gathered, this freshly created company or simply a group working on a project just don't get along together. And I'm going to come to some of these points later on, but it's a sad statistics that, well, depending on a country, 70 to 90% of startups fail in first half of the year or even less. Yeah. So, you know, they apply different things, but most startups fail. And there's really nothing pleasant or nice about it. Usually it's pretty miserable. You're in debt maybe to your family or investors, and then suddenly you fail, and you have to clear the mess after you. Because of all of these different aspects, you have a certain culture which is very actually common and quite similar through all the world, and it really doesn't matter where you're gonna go. This hacker, entrepreneur, hustler, now the board is also fun. Culture kind of repeats itself. Either you go to United States or here in Lithuania. And it has some different patterns. What I find the most nice, it's this flexible, modern, open, transparent culture, which for me is best represented by open offices. And like in the past, or if you go to a bank or some serious institution, you have these cubicles, you have offices or closed doors, very hierarchical. So startups on the other end usually have a very flat, open culture. Most people know how much is who's earning, what's the culture in the company, and so on. So you have to think about this. If you're thinking about a startup or working for one, if it's something that you'd be looking for. So then we come to this important point of fundraising, raising some capital. And it all, because it affects everything that startups do and are. So usually it's triple F or FFFs, which stands for friends, family, and fools, who believe you that you're gonna succeed, and then you fail miserably, you lose all of your money, and you don't talk to your friends, family, and you're trying to run away from fools who are hiring hitmen and something. Business angels. Everyone knows, I think, who are business angels by now. Rich individuals usually have done it in the past, earn a bunch of money, and doing it for more, I would say, for more of philanthropical reasons, because as a business angel, there is no way that it makes, well, from my point of view, it makes sense unless you can invest per year to 20 or more companies to actually get a return from a startup. Unless you invest in, of course, less risky businesses like restaurant business again, right? And then most important in this collection is venture capital, or VCs, venture capitalists, who are usually experienced professionals who gather together. They raise a fund from big pension funds, big investment funds. They raise anything from $20 million to hundreds or billions of dollars, and then they start investing into these startups. The way they do it is they invest in a lot of companies, and because 90% fail, right? We remember this, right? So if the company invests in 10 or 20 per year, there is chance that one will be successful. Because average startup, especially in internet and software business, is so cheap, it's just basically two, three people working on a product. Even if they fail, the cost is very, very small. But if one of these 10 or whatever become even average success in startup terms, meaning have an exit of $30-40 million, or they cover all the failures and they bring even in return. However, we've heard, we hear a lot of criticism for venture capitalists, especially in our area, for being aggressive, not investing enough, having very hard terms to negotiate with, and all kinds of different things. But nowadays, from my perspective, it's usually the failure from a startup to startupers to get themselves educated and actually build a product that works and be able to deliver. And then you can negotiate if you have if you're looking for a business partner who's going to bring in the money. If you have something to offer, then you can negotiate. So why do venture capitalists and business angels invest? Well, I kind of covered it already, but the idea here is that you have big opportunity, which equals big risk that they're going to fail, but it usually in the investment world, if you have a big risk and big opportunity, you're going to have a huge return, as in money. So what big opportunities are we talking about? And I keep repeating software and internet is because software and internet grows the fastest and has the easiest way to spread and attract users and customers. So for example, everyone knows Twitter, Facebook, and Google Plus, right? Three different social networks. And this is just a small chart showing how long it took them to reach 20 million users. So Facebook here and Twitter being older companies, and keep in mind that even at that point of time, even internet penetration was different and internet speed was different. Usability of a product and the way people treated their privacy and everything was different. But then you look at the newly, newly launched product by Google Plus. It took them 24 days to reach 20 million users worldwide. This is exactly the opportunity and the thing that investors are looking for, and you should be as a startuper if you want to have one, of course. So if you go to any website of any VC, if you ask them, I guarantee you, and if you ask them, what are you looking in a startup? What do you invest in? I guarantee you that this is going to be more or less the answers. Well, we're looking for early stage, high potential. This is my investment voice. High risk, high traction companies with some novel technology or business model in high tech industries. And sometimes, especially investors from markets with more investors like Silicon Valley or London, they will have a specific industry they're going to be talking. So let's say biotech or telecommunications. But in general, this is exactly what they're going to be looking for. So if we go over it, it's a company is looking for repeatable, highly scalable business idea and a business model, which basically is in a quiet, closed technology industry and specifically focused on all things connected to internet. So also hardware, because hardware kind of started all of it, and there is no internet and internet startups without hardware. And nowadays, there's more and more things in biotechnology, Internet of Things, basically meaning any kinds of appliances, electric appliances, connecting them to internet, collecting data, and so on. But this is what a startup is. And if you're opening a restaurant business, a selling shoes, unless you're going to connect them to an internet, if you're starting a social responsible business, you're not a startup yet, unless you're going to meet these criteria. And of course, I'm open to discussion. But again, and I'm going to use cliche kind of example of Facebook, but this is what you should be looking if you're thinking about startup. This is what they are thinking in Silicon Valley, and this is what investors are looking for. If you're going to meet all these things, you're going to be able to raise capital and so on. To TrackDuck, to my startup, I have no qualification yet to say what is a successful startup and how to get to one, but I can say what is how to survive, which we already survived more than 6 months. I feel already successful. So, and from these 10, 11 months, these are my seven kind of lessons. And I think reflections on what helped us, three co-founders and now, eight people in our team to maintain TrackDuck. So firstly, you have to feel the pain that you're going to solve. So aim at your industry, aim at something, at the business that you know, and try to find something that doesn't work, that really has, is there is illness that you can cure the pain. So once you find it, you need the skills clearly to solve it. You need the commitment. And I keep coming back here to the pain, because if you don't feel the pain, you're not going to have the commitment, and so on. So from historic reasons and other reasons, statistically, it's mostly two co-founders, one of a business side, one from a technical side or something like that. But three are becoming more common. So, and this is pure statistics. Average year of a startuper, of a successful startup companies have recently came down to 28, 27. In the past, it's been a lot more. It's been 35, 20 or something years ago. But usually you're looking at something like 28 years old people, two or three co-founders. Also, there's not enough to have a pain and skills and so on. You have to match the opportunity, the big opportunity that I was talking about. You need, of course, luck and to be in the right place in the right time. But luck favors the brave, so basically being outgoing and hustling and so on. And you have to have fun. So this is us and my co-founders from Belarus, Anton and Zhenya in the middle, and Anton. And we're here just after graduating Startup Sauna and, well, basically closing our first small investment in Finland. A little bit drunk, had a nice party. And if I would have one recommendation for you people, especially for those who are already working on a startup or want to start a startup, go to steveblank.com. Steve Blank, like the grandfather or duke of startups, has this amazing website where he keeps posting new great content, and he has a bunch of great resources. He has collected the other people resources for startups, from technology to management. He has hundreds of his own presentations, video classes, even his own course, the Udacity. So Steve Blank is the guy, and his website is steveblank.com. And that's one thing I recommend to everyone. And yeah, thank you. So questions or no questions, and I get off here. Yes, senor.
So I was kind of thinking about, you know, what a startup is and what a startup is not.
Good, thank you, good.
Yeah, and I was thinking of some particular companies in Lithuania, and I wanted actually to discuss with you and the audience just some examples, right? So, for example, what do you think about Piku.lt? Do you think it is? Do you think it was a startup at some point?
I have no knowledge about what they're planning to do or what they're doing right now, so I'm not really qualified to answer this. However, I would say that no, right now they're not a startup.
Why would you say
they're not? Because they have found a business model, and if we came back to a simple definition, right? Scalability, repeatable, and business model. So they found the business model, but they're more or less staying in Lithuania and neighboring markets, Latvia, and I think they're expanding something else, but they're not innovating on it anymore as far as I see, and maybe they have something coming out. So I don't see where it would be highly repeatable and scalable either from technology or business side. They're kind of doing like many other great companies are doing, and they're a great company, but they're not a startup anymore because they're pretty, I'm pretty sure they know who their clients are and how to sell them and what are the projections of their sales. So they have answered all the three questions, if you remember. So they're not a startup anymore.
When do you stop being a startup, in your view?
Can I? Oh, so coming back to these three questions, then you're sure what is your business model, who are your customers, and what kind of product you're selling to them, and then, of course, it's repeatable and scalable, so you're a startup. Does that make sense?
What about, let's move on to another question.
Does anyone else have a question? Because I know this guy, and he not, like, we're going to be spending this weekend together. In an event for startups, and so he can ask me all this. But anyone else?
I think it's relevant what we're
That you think so. Oh, please.
It's an event.
It's high. That's German event. In Berlin, and it's for the... Yeah, I know. That's their choice. it's like an event for the best accelerators and their teams, so we're going there as part of Startup Sauna. And I'm going to be presenting on in the morning of Saturday.
You said that you are now a team of 8 people, 3 co-founders,
yes,
and 5 members.
Yeah.
So how did you attract the other members of the team? Was it salary? And if it wasn't, do you think it's possible to motivate other team members when you have no money? You know, you cannot offer salary, maybe something else?
Well, now we're lucky enough to be... So, great question. Now we're lucky enough to actually pay salary. We're not paying a good salary like that they could be getting as a great professionals that they are in the market. The way we motivate them is, firstly, they're doing great stuff. They're working on a product that they like. They're seeing, they're feeling the pain. They feel committed. They have the skills to solve it. So that's a fit number one. But then we're also motivating them with options in a company. And I think maybe Justas is going to talk more about percentages and, right, shares?
No, I'm not going to speak, but I could answer.
Well, we have a pool of shares that we dedicated to our first employees and upcoming employees that are going to join us. And we're giving them this option from this share pool, so they feel motivation on the long term side, and it's like easy already to evaluate it. We have gotten some small investment. We're talking to some other investors, so they can even see how already the shares have clear value and there's growth and potential.
Just small clarification: can you tell what's the size of this pool?
It's for average startup. It depends. It depends on a country. In the United States, there are statistics that usually startups start out from 10 to 20%. But this is like large numbers. You cannot find anything from 5% to 20%. So but you're like as a co-founder, you're taking away shares and of a company from yourself. So usually it's not bigger for sure than 20%. So an hour is somewhere in that range. So, okay, final question. And
as a co-founder, do you pay yourself a salary?
Yes.
And after how many months you started paying that salary?
After 6. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Eddie. How do you feel now? Better? With a bit of a clue what the startup is? Okay, before we move on, just a small announcement about the possibility to announce. That's the improvised board of announcements. So if you have a startup and you are looking for a new team member, if you are looking for a designer, an engineer, a developer, or whatever, you can just come here after the event and leave your contacts and drop a message like what you're looking for, and maybe somebody from this crowd will approach you after. Okay, so now we move on, and my question for you would be, who of you have heard of the company called manodrabuji.lt? Raise your hands. Cool. Who of you have an account there? That's cool. So, please meet Justas. Justas is one of the co-founders of a startup which is called manodrabuji.lt, or in the English language, it's Vinted. Justas, here you go.
Hello, everyone. thank you. So, I arranged my presentation to be pretty short, like 20 minutes, and to be considering that people here are not started yet their own startups, and they have kind of little knowledge about that kind of business models and that kind of companies. So I will just to try to be very pragmatic and try to explain things like very simply, like 1+1, that kind of methodology. So myself, I'm a co-founder of Vinted. That's international name. That's our new brand, actually, for markets outside of Lithuania, of the company Mano Drabužiai. So Mano Drabužiai has been started 5 years ago by me and my colleagues. So we started like as typically two guys in a garage, except that it was not garage, it was the bar. So, and then we, for 3 years, we were kind of trying to grow the company. Actually, we were doing pretty well. And then last few years in our company became super exceptional. Today we have 110 employees working in the companies. Around 60 of them are based here in Lithuania, in Vilnius. That's our engineering product development team. So most talented engineers, designers, product managers, they are working in Vinted. So I'm sure if you're a software engineer, you should have heard a lot about our company, the atmosphere we have, the possibilities, technologies, the processes, and other great stuff we are building here. My aim is like to replicate the best knowledge and know-how, tips and tricks, which are already existing in the great companies out of Silicon Valley, and not only in Silicon Valley. I'm really inspired by the companies like 37 Signals. I don't know how many of you heard Valve or GitHub as a company, not a product. So those are kind of inspirations I'm trying really to replicate here in Lithuania. And I call that Vinted is kind of Silicon Valley in Lithuania. So we have very beautiful, huge office. You are everyone welcome just to come over to check it out, to see, to feel the atmosphere of a startup, which I'm proud to be. So what I am going to speak about, forgot. So very shortly, what is Vinted? I see a lot of guys here, so I found that this question is very relevant. I will present from my personal view how I see, how do I define what is a startup, and I could answer the question about is pigwheel.lt is a startup or not. Speaking about startups and business models of startups, there are like hundreds, so many nuances you have to be aware. So not to make this thing super complicated, I will just present three cases or three nuances. One from the product side, which is going to be tightly related to Vinted case. One from the marketing and financing as well. So what is Vinted? So for the guys, so we target like 17, 27 year old young ladies, girls. It's a combination, it's a product which is a combination of three very important pillars or areas. So first of all, it's a marketplace where members can come and they can list using their phone, smartphone, the picture of their clothing item they don't wear anymore, so it could be hoodie or a dress or whatever, and then they can, other members can see that, they can search, browse, chat around and buy it, and it becomes nothing else than peer-to-peer marketplace. So we don't do any logistics, warehouse, nothing. We just build technology which allows people to connect one person to another one. We do $8 million of GMV per month, which accounts to 500,000 transactions per month. So the second pillar is that Vinted is as well is a social network. People go there not only to shop or to buy the stuff. There is lots of social activities going on. So we have like forums, discussions, commenting, liking, favorite, all that kind of stuff. Few metrics to indicate how social Vinted is. So on average, each daily active user, they spend 1 hour per day. It's average. So some of them spend 20 minutes, some of them they spend 4 hours, and so on. From the engagement point of view, we have today, well, it's old slide. So today we have 1.2 million monthly active users. So monthly active user is the one who comes at least once per month to the product. And like 40% of that, they are daily active users. So the engagement ratio is very high. So those who go to on daily basis, they visit they use our product pretty frequently. And the third area of Vinted is that it's as well as kind of inspiration discovery channel, something like you can think of Pinterest, where you can just We're just releasing a new feature called Newsfeed, something like Facebook, but combination of Facebook and Pinterest, where you can just go there and just see the feed of news, and it's infinite. We have 100,000 of new listings per day on Vinted, so you are not able to look all of them in any case. So that's shortly to give you kind of sense what is our company about. And let's move to my definition. How do I define what is a startup? So I define that startup as it could be any company, not necessarily it should be internet, web, whatever. It could be any company who has to convey to two criteria. One criteria is super fast growth. And the second criteria is infinite potential. Infinite, of course, infinite. It never can be infinite on the planet Earth, but almost close to that. So why kebab shop is not could not be considered as a startup? Because even though it can grow super fast and get from 1 to 50 daily customers in, I don't know, 2 days, but the potential is very limited to 50 customers. That's it. Why McDonald's could not be a startup? Well, even though the potential is very high and they can still grow a lot, but they cannot keep the super fast growth pace. In the next slide, I'm going to speak about what does mean super fast growth. So that's not a startup. Why Facebook is a startup? Yeah, because they can keep very fast growth of, like, I would say, my criteria of startup is like 5% of your most important key performance indicator, KPI, on week. So each week you grow on average by 5%. That's super fast. And infinite potential, that you can keep this pace for not 2 months, not 2 years, but 10 years. So this is kind of the potential of the startup. So I would like this to relate to Vinted as a company. This chart represents kind of our monthly growth since we launched. We launched in 2008-09. We aim to have at least 5% week-on-week growth, which accounts to 20% month-on-month growth. So our kind of, this chart particularly represents kind of monthly visits, how many visits we have on month. So, and as I mentioned, 5%, something like that. So if you can handle the business and have that kind of growth, that's excellent. That's something everyone is looking for.
Sorry, what happened in 2009? I mean, 2012, what happened? Like, why did it suddenly change?
Yeah, I will speak about this. You could see that it's getting exponential, and that's actually some other topics I'm going to address in this presentation. Almost infinite potential, even though we are growing. So last year, Vinted grew 4x. A year ago, the growth was 3.2x, and a year ago, it was 2.5x. So it means every year we grow faster and faster, even though we are already 5 years in the market. In the markets you see on the right side, it's our kind of markets we are operating. So today what we have just 4% of our kind of potential. So it's not infinite, but like if we take United States, UK, Germany, France, Poland, Spain, Italy, we can still grow there 25x. So for at least 2-3 next years, we have enough of space to grow. But then you can go to Latin America, other markets. So there are plenty of opportunities. So you should be looking for that. So that's kind of second criteria. Yeah, and not to make my presentation too complicated, I'll just go to some nuances which are very important in particular startup business. So let's take case of Vinted. So Vinted, as you know, it's a product. So we are kind of app, like just to mention, 80% of all the usage of Vinted or Mano Drabužiai on average is on smartphone app, so iOS or Android. So we are not desktop anymore. So every feature you develop in the product, you don't develop that randomly. You don't want to add button just to be nice or something you think is based on your gut feeling. No, that doesn't work. Every feature you develop is to increase the growth or potential. So if we have the growth when we started early, here you see growth was, I don't know, 5 or 4% on month. We aim to improve the product and measure that the growth, that the new features would result to some particular KPI improvement. So it could be or growth improvement, or engagement improvement, or transaction rate improvement, or whatever, or time on site improvement, or member retention. So there are lots of metrics you take care about when you're doing that kind of business. And my message here is that you don't do that random. You do that with an aim. The second point is that every feature from the product point of view has to be A/B tested. Not just because A/B testing is cool, but because you can very easily fuck up everything if you release something you didn't test. I don't know how many of you have been familiar with just the concept of A/B testing. Those who are not, so basically it's a concept meaning that when you develop a new feature, so you don't roll out it to everyone. You roll out it to 10% of the members, or 50%, whatever, and then you look how this group of the people who are using your new feature are acting compared to those who are not using that feature, right? And then if you see that the metrics you take care of, they are improving, so that's great. And if you see that metrics are not improving, so you should not allow yourself to roll it out. And at Vinted, we had many situations when we developed something and we think that's, oh wow, that's cool, that's fascinating, and actually just after A/B testing, we had just to cancel. Sorry, no, it just doesn't work. Even though at the beginning we thought it will work. So, and that kind of data-driven approach in each startup, modern startup or professional startup, is a standard, it's a norm. You cannot act and nothing else. And this leads to the fact that, as I mentioned, so this chart represents that the growth is exploding. It's just because we aim to develop the product and the features and all the changes in the way that our internal metrics we take care of would improve, not to not improve. Here is an example. This chart, I just took randomly one chart. It represents of the new feature we are developing and testing at the moment. This chart shows nothing else than member retention. What's retention? Retention is that if we take, for example, in this particular case, zero is how many members who registered on particular day, let's say it's January 2nd, right? Let's take on January 2nd. How many members registered on January 2nd returned on January 2nd? Well, it should be 100% or something wrong. So the blue and green dots should be the same. Because you register, so it means you are on the same. So how many of them came back next day? So it usually drops to, not everyone comes back, so maybe 50, 20, 70, whatever percentage is coming back. How many of them are coming back on the third day, on the fourth, fifth, sixth, and so on. And then that's called cohort of the member engagement. So we develop new feature. For example, we are rolling out newsfeed, and we see, we test A/B test, and we, for example, particularly in that case, we look at the cohorts. So we see that members who registered and fall out into this sector where feed is kind of enabled, so they tend to return better to the product. So it means that the feature is excellent. We have to roll it out. Another example. We in the United States, we have integrated payment solutions so that you can actually purchase the items using your credit card. So we did a test at the beginning when we launched the feature. When you click I want to buy it and you enter your credit card data, the button next was, you know, on the top left side. This is Android screenshot. And we tested that against the moving that button, making very large, visible, old school way, just down here. We tested that and we saw that kind of purchases per active user increased 11%, buyers per active user increased 9%. Excellent, small change, transaction, more transactions, product better, more revenues. And this is what we are looking for. This is the explanation of why it's getting better and better at our company. Second point is marketing nuance. So as well as I said with the product, so kind of data-driven approach is a kind of standard, and the same is with the marketing. Every marketing action is done to support the growth. It's not done randomly. There is no sense at our business, we discovered, there is no sense to do some kind of, I don't know, stickers, PR campaigns, I don't know, anything which takes lots of time and could not be scaled to hundreds of thousands or millions or whatever. Even though it's very hard to measure what's the effect if I give flyers to people, you know, I don't know what's the effect, how much cost a flyer, how many of them came back, how many of them returned, and so on. So that's why all the marketing has to be kind of measured very heavily. As well, every marketing action is A/B tested. So meaning that, let's take a simple example. So Vinted is the largest Facebook customer in Eastern Europe. Why? Because when you browse Facebook app, you see sometimes sponsored stories, or not sponsored, apps, where you can click install the app, right? So you can purchase that service from Facebook. We create, I don't know, hundreds of different marketing messages, banners, whatever. We put that to Facebook. Of course, we don't use only Facebook, but just to make it simple, you know. And we run over the night, I don't know, 20 different campaigns, or sometimes 100 different campaigns, and we see how many people click of them, what is the CTR rate, what's the cost per click, what's the cost per install. We track that on our app, and we know that this particular member came through this campaign, or that campaign, or that campaign. And then over the time, after a week, 2-3 weeks, we can see how the behavior of those different campaigns are taking an effect on the member base. And sometimes, you know, we end up kind of acquiring members for very low cost per registration. But if we took a look at the cost per active member after, let's say, a month, then the price can go super high, because, you know, you can have cheap clicks but then no activity, or expensive clicks and super good activity, and sometimes expensive clicks are better. So you measure, when you're doing marketing, you measure what is important for you: cost per transaction, cost per seller, cost per buyer, cost per active member after 1 week, or whatever. And you A/B test everything, and your aim is to optimize the cost, find the formula which works, find the channels. Is it Facebook? Not Facebook? I don't know, ads, whatever. So it's for you. And you have to use only those marketing actions which are scalable. So PR is not scalable, flyers are hardly scalable, and so on. So digital is the most scalable channel, by the way. So we use only digital. Here is an example. This chart represents the growth of the markets we launched: Vinted, Germany, France, Poland, United States. Germany was the kind of, those are since the launch date. You know, in the timeline, they are very kind of separated. So we learned doing kind of very efficient marketing when we launched Poland last year in February. Then we improved much better, and when we launched France, we were able in France, let's say, after a few months, to achieve the same results which were achieved in Germany after 30 months, just because we improved our marketing much better. So you see, United States today is our last market we are launching since September last year. It was very tough there due to market specifics, big competition, huge price, and so on. We figure out the formula now, and we are able to support marketing in a very efficient way and have super fast growth as well. Yeah, and my last message is about investment nuance. So Vinted is a company backed by VC fund. We raised our first Series A round last year, January. Very happy about the investors, the company. When you are pitching to investors, speaking to them, you know, they never care about the revenues of the past or whatever. You know, everyone is taking care about the future after X year. So when I pitch Vinted to the investors, they are buying not what we are now, they are buying what we are going to be after 8 years, right? And if I could demonstrate that our growth is like this, we can be a very successful company, we can get super high valuation. If I show that our growth is like this, so we are not so super successful company, because after 8 months, compared to this, after 8 years, or some X years, you know, we are going to be 100 times smaller than the other company having that base. So it's very important to understand what could be the future after X years and so on. And valuation of the company, how much company is worth, is basically decided on two key drivers. Is the speed, like I showed here, how fast you're growing, and what's the potential. So, of course, many other things. What is the user base? What's your knowledge? What's your experience? What are the risks they minimize and so on. But if I have to choose two, I would say those are the two. So if you're able to build the business or the concept which has super high potential and which could be growing super fast, so go to Mindaugas, who's going to speak next after me, and I'm sure you're going to make the deal with him. Yeah. Thanks. Any questions? Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. First of all, how do you rate your potential in your case? I mean.
Yeah. Very easy. So, roughly, of course, precisely you cannot calculate potential. So in Lithuania there is Mano Drabužiai.lt, which is already saturated for 2 years, meaning that it grew like this. Like that, and then this, because that's not enough of people in Lithuania to use the product. So we have approximately like 50% of our target audience penetration in Lithuania. So we roughly, to be conservative, take the, let's say, United States, France, other markets, we can reach maybe not 50, but 30% of that, and we have kind of very good validation point. But that's in our case because we have Lithuanian company, but if you wouldn't have, so that would be a bit harder. But sometimes you don't need to precise that super precisely, you know, because you can have a sense. Because if you're building instant messaging app, well, your potential is super high. You don't need even to prove. But if you're building some kind of, I know, very specific, I know, e-commerce project for reselling, I don't know, used mouses, for example, so then it's debatable. You need to prove that. Yes? Well, I could just tell from my story. So the first investor I met was angel investor, Lithuanian guy I just met almost randomly. And I think it's very good evolution for any startup to raise money locally to prove and move the company to the next level, and then go to the higher investor, move the company to next level, and so on. When we raised Series A, so we did not look for the investor, but we were basically noticed by our growth, because investors, you know, they are looking for companies. They use many sophisticated software, which kind of looks, crawls the internet, and if the company is really growing fast, you will be under the radar automatically, so they will come to you. And in our case, it was the case, they came to us. Yes?
What is your profession? Are you an IT guy or
something? Yes, I'm a professional software engineer. I started my professional career as developer when I was 14 years old, like in China. So, and I have been working as a developer for a few companies here in Lithuania mostly. And I started Mano Drabužiai when I was 24. I left my job when I was 26 and moved fully to Vinted. So I have a master's degree in computer science, so full engineer. All right, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Justas. It's a great pleasure to have you here. All right, time to move on. And Eddie and Justas already mentioned several times, many of times, a term investment or investor or venture capital or stuff like that. And this is something what is very important when it comes to startups. And last year, in the very end of the last year, before the Christmas, we heard some good news that there is a newly established venture capital fund in Lithuania, which is ready to invest in startups. And here today we have Mindaugas, Nextury Ventures, and he's gonna talk about the perspective of investors and what they are looking for than they are looking for startups. Welcome.
Thank you. Well, this is really smart of you, Demanta, because I remember when you said that I should come and speak about it, it was interesting because I think you said I should define the difference between what is a startup and what is not a startup. So it's covered. So I'm in a difficult situation because I was preparing for that, but it's good because I will change the course of discussion a little bit because so much has been covered by Eddie and Justas. Couple of things. Suddenly, I often use the phrase through the miracle of time, you know, when you cook food, through the miracle of time, you get a nice dish. Now, through the miracle of time, I suddenly realized I'm probably the oldest guy in this audience, though I still feel very young. So startup business is indeed a business for young people. Eddie said it's typically 20, 28 years old person who starts the business. But Eddie, do you know when the startup movement or venture...
28 is for successful startups that have reached a level of investment or revenue. So nowadays the age is going down and down.
Yeah, okay. So that could be true, but do you know when actually startup kind of business started, venture capital backed business started, and how it started in Silicon Valley?
In the 70s, 74, something like that.
No, earlier. Actually, well, not to quiz you more on this, but in 1957, there was a company, actually a spin-off, which was then a startup backed by venture capitalists called Fairchild Semiconductor.
That company gave birth to several companies. One of them was actually Intel. It was eight engineers, you would say at that time not very young guys with some experience in corporation, who started
this Fairchild Semiconductor, who was... It doesn't exist anymore, as far as I can tell, but it was very successful. So Silicon Valley took time to develop since the first venture capital-backed deal, 1957. In Lithuania, we are just at the very beginning of venture capital. The first companies who branded themselves as venture capitalists or rizikos kapitalo fondai, they appeared just several years ago, like 3 or 4 years ago. Lit Capital, Bolt Cap, you have Practica Capital, you have a couple of angels, and so this, we are in the very early age of this ecosystem. So while it seems to you that this startup movement in Lithuania is not big enough, well, it can't be big enough because it is so young. We're a small company and we have a lot of potential to grow in this. So my partner Ilya Laurs and myself, we've spoken already for some time about finding a niche in this venture capital world where we could fit, and what we could do yet differently, not to start competing somehow with other venture capitalists, but to fill the gaps that still exist today. So you could say we have started with a name, which we thought should actually tell what we do. So Nextury is a combination of next and century. So we're actually looking for the next big thing. Big, as described by Eddie, big, as described by Justas, the company that has the potential to demonstrate in its near future the hockey stick growth. Be it growth in revenue or be it growth in users, and be part of that infinite potential game. Now, we want to produce as many startups as possible because we are a venture capital fund. We have the same challenge of probably 9 of 10 startups failing. One, just one, being very successful. Well, that's the statistics. Now, we sat together and said, okay, can we try to tweak this statistics a little bit and have a higher success rate? So we said, yes, we probably can if we apply our experience to startups, saying that we will become a boutique venture capital fund. We will not work with as many as possible startups, as many as we can afford, but we will work with as many as we can afford in terms of time, in terms of sharing our experience. So talking about Nextury Ventures, yes, we are a venture capital fund. We tend, for now, for the foreseeable future, to look at the very early stage companies that have this high potential and fast growth potential. We will engage very closely with these companies to actually provide them strategic guidance and operational guidance, not maybe so much guidance even, but support. For that, we have created an executive advisory network. So our strategy is we will engage very experienced people. Typically, that means by this definition, quite older people than the typical startup people, to actually help these companies find the right way in this world and open the doors as quickly as possible so that they can move faster with these ideas. Now, naturally, this model means we cannot engage with a very broad number of startups because we are just two partners. We have other advisors who have a lesser engagement. So we have to be picky and we have to choose our companies very carefully. In many cases, we realize that in Lithuania now there's a lot of startups. I was actually surprised when I saw this issue of Bazanes Start, which said top 93 startups in Lithuania a month ago. I was like, top 93? That sounds strange. I mean, you could easily find top 100 because that exists. But yet, while that top 100 exists, if you look in through that top 100, we realize, and it's not only us, I mean, this is the commonly known truth among those people who are willing to exist, the quality of a typical Lithuanian startup today is very low. It's just an idea without any realistic plan. Now, realistic, I mean, not necessarily, you know, with all the financial projections in Excel, that doesn't make any sense for an early stage company, but at least with the good idea of what you want to do, what human need you are addressing, who your customers are, why would someone be interested in buying your service, and, well, not to forget, actually, at least some idea how you are going to monetize that cool thing. Actually, I went now through a large number of discussions with many startup teams, and when you ask this question, so that sounds cool. I mean, yeah, looks good, but how will you collect money? Do you have any idea how to collect money? Now, a lot of them, and I wouldn't say the percentage, I wouldn't lie, I didn't count, but more than more than 50% of them cannot answer this question. So, you know, we said we will have to go through a large number of startups, but pick just a small number of them, work with a few select who show this potential, who have the ambition, who want to develop, and who actually have a good idea. Now, we also have some ideas of our own, and that's another model of how we will operate. We will actually be recruiting teams to start working on those ideas that we have identified. So we'll be actively engaged with the market, telling very soon about which areas we're looking in which areas we we do believe. So for now, we have two companies in our portfolio that we have already announced. You might have heard of them. One is Cheap Data. It's a company that was established late spring last year. And it's a company that addresses a traveler's need to have cheap mobile data connectivity while abroad. Those of you who traveled probably know how expensive and how unpredictable those costs are today. So we have found a technical solution how to address it. Now we're building it and we're working on the marketing strategy, how to launch it on the market. The second company is Dalinuosi LT. Are any of you users of Dalinuosi LT yet? Wow, okay. I mean, this company has just, it started actually more than a year ago, but they went on the market literally this summer. So it's very new. It's a bit of a relative to Mano Drabužiai. The concept of sharing economy is really big, and there's a lot of niches that you can fill for sharing economy. And Mano Drabužiai addresses simply the same thing. Why constantly buy new stuff and throw away while you can enjoy it for some time and then share it with the others? So this is what we have announced so far. We have two other companies already, I would say, invested in, but not yet announced. We're working on some details. You will hear of them soon. And our plan is by the end of 2014 to have 10 companies in our portfolio. Now, I'd like to tell you, because I'm the oldest guy in the audience, I kind of feel that, I'd like to tell you also a bit of my personal story. Not because my personal story matters, but because I think you, through your life, through your professional life, you might experience exactly the same thing, or you might meet people with exactly similar background as myself, and there's a potential for partnership. So, Eddie, you actually mentioned that as well, but I come from this environment. For the past 15 years, I've been successfully working in a corporate world. I started in IBM, worked for 5 years, and then for the past almost 10 years, I worked for Microsoft. Now, don't be misled by this picture. Corporations these days do not look like that. It's not as boring as this, but yet, compared to startup world, is more similar to this than the startup world. While you have all the flexibility as an employee, you're still there to fulfill some task that you have very little control of. That's actually the reality of corporate life. You learn a lot, it's a good experience. You travel a lot, you still meet with a lot of people, and it's enjoyable, but at a certain point, for me it was after 15 years, I started thinking, wow, is this really something I want to do for the rest of my life? And my clear answer in my mind was, this is not it. Luckily, at Microsoft, I was engaged a lot with startups. So it was kind of easy for me to say, you know what, enough of this corporate world. Now I feel good enough. I can, being of that age, you say you have collected some responsibilities. You have to be able to fulfill those. But now I can afford to start something of my own. And I said, startup. Now, I don't think actually, Eddie, that the startup is that strictly technically defined as you did. Though it was a very good definition. I liked it actually. I listened to it and said, he's probably right. Because one of the ideas I had was that, that's not the slide I wanted to show. I'd like to go, for example, into a restaurant business or start a yogurt ice cream company. That's actually one of the startups that was among the winners at the as an start competition, if I remember well. And then I said, oh God, really? I mean, yes, that's cool. That will be my own business. And I like ice cream. You know, it's so good. There's nothing bad in making ice cream. There's sometimes maybe not so good to eat so much of it, but it's not really as exciting as I was, looking for. And I'll go back to this slide. I thought ice cream business is actually so similar to what I was doing before, to corporate world. From not technical perspective, not from work content perspective, but from the fact that, you know, it's like a Formula One race. There's so little freedom, there's so much into perfection, into proper timing, into, you know, you count millimeters. You know the racetrack, you know everything what happens. You compete on it's a hard work, but it's different. I call it, and probably I'm wrong, I'm not a Formula One driver, but to me, Formula, at least for the past couple of years, it's been very predictive. Predictive. You know who's gonna win more or less. You know what they're going to do. You look at how they're taking the bends, and you know, should he do that 1 meter, or has he done it 1 meter too early or 1 meter too late? And you know what's coming next. So it's very what I thought. It's very predictable. So I thought, you know, start a business to me is a bit like Dakar. Eddie doesn't agree.
I agree. I like the example.
You like the example? Okay. Well, why Dakar? Well, because of its unpredictability. I mean, you are out there almost sometimes, like in this picture, on your own in the middle of nowhere. Nobody's gone through that before you, and you're really finding out something new. You are finding out the way to survive. In Dakar, to me, the winning is not really the necessary ultimate goal. It's reaching the finish that you should already be happy about. Actually, Dakar is going on right now. I didn't follow it that closely, but our Lithuanian teams seem to be still there. Hopefully, they will finish. We know, you know, they will not be most likely the winner, the number one, but even if they reach a certain point, they will. We will already be happy for them, and they, as racers, will already be happy. So same thing with startups. You know, Eddie has been, again, I'm referring a lot to you, but I liked your presentation. I like yours as well, but you gave a lot of data points. You've showed the graph of how quickly you can reach, a certain number of users, Facebook, Twitter, and Google+. Now, to me, that was a bit of a wrong comparison, because Facebook and Twitter were real startups. These guys have started from scratch. Facebook has started when social media, an average person on the street didn't know what social media is. I think the term at that time didn't even exist as social media. Now, Google+ is not a startup. Google owns the world's population through the search engine, and you know, they created a spin-off, which immediately gave them this huge amount of users. It's a bit like Formula One. Now, Google has done it before and they have failed. Now, they're trying it again. So, start a business is exactly the same. Now, we have these Lithuanian racers on Dakar who have been there before and haven't reached the finish. They're starting it again. This is the startup spirit. You are not there to achieve, you know, your ultimate perfection in what you're doing, but it's really allowing yourself to be wild and experience something totally new. So, here I am in this business, not exactly a startup myself, but really very willing to engage with startups and see how the experience that I gathered throughout my life, and Ilya, my partner on this venture, who also has quite a lot of experience in building a startup, which by now you would say Getjar, his first company, is no longer really a startup. It's a viable business in itself, which is doing pretty well for a number of years. Still a startup, yes, it is a startup, I know. But it's a totally different, from my perspective, a totally different world, which I'm looking forward to enjoy so much. Another thing about startups is actually coded in this picture. Now, I got this idea listening to one very interesting person, Ken Singer, who is from Berkeley University, but he also works a lot in Kaunas Technical University with their business students and technical students, and helps KTU startups. He actually gave this comparison. He said, look, to build a successful startup business, it is like in the rafting sport. You need a good team. You really need a good team that's dedicated. There must be a team leader, but every team member is equal. A team leader can do no more or less unless the full complete team functions, unless everyone feels part of it and is, you know, dying as hard for success as every other member of the team. At the beginning, as you said, there's no money. You eat shitty food and you live in your parents' home, but you do it for some purpose, and you do it together. There are ways to make sure that you get some living means, like investors can help. There's investors for different stages, but team is very important. Now, that good team needs a good product. Now, be it an internet portal, be it a hardware piece, be it, I don't know, even, you know, a chocolate bar or something, but you need to build a good product. Now, in this picture, that's a boat. It needs to be strong, it needs to, be able to survive in different waters. But also, very importantly, and often overlooked by startups, that like this boat needs water to be in the game, a startup needs to make sure that there is market for the product that this team is developing. Yes, you can hope to create the totally new market, but still there must be some material to create that market. So once you make sure there's water, expect that this water sometimes will be very quiet, sometimes you will have this white water. And that's why you need a good team to carry that product through. And another thing about startups, and particularly in Lithuania, and this really comes from my relatively short experience from in engagement, to build a successful startup in Lithuania, especially in internet business, look worldwide. Don't do something that you believe is, can only work in a small market, or start by thinking, I'll do it for Lithuania and I'll have a nice life. I think by definition, you should look at the startup as a product that you are ready to sell. Now, to sell that product, you need to build the value of that product. The only way to build the value of that product is to look worldwide. Then you will get interested addresses from different investors who will be then valuing it the way you expect, and will pay back for your sacrifices that you made eating shitty food and living with parents and maybe spending long nights at the PC building this product. And the final idea is this. Again, comes from the same guy, Ken Singer. It's not my thought, but I thought it's a brilliant thought. The guy said, when I first came to Lithuania, I was so surprised that Lithuanians are so proud by a failed project. Lituanica. They said, oh, these are our heroes. They are even on our banknote. And what did they do? Well, they flew over Atlantic and they crashed. It's like,
strange guys. I mean, they're celebrating the plane crash. And then he said it was a discovery for him. And then I truly believe it's a good example. He said, look, Lithuania is by definition a startup nation. Now, Lituanica was a startup project. These two guys had a brilliant idea, and they wanted to do something nice for the country, nice for their families, and they persevered. They went through years of trying, they achieved, they built a plane, they flew over Atlantic, they crashed, they died. Now, the beauty of startups is, look, a lot of bad things can happen, but you will not die. You will always, after the first crash, have a chance to do it again and again and again and again. As long as you do it in a way that other people will appreciate that you've done something because you were learning. Not because you were, you know, willing to do something wrong, something, how should I call it, something that's, you know, not supposed to be done. So as long as you stay truthful and faithful, the investors and your partners will forgive your failures. But your next project will be more successful, and your third project will be even more successful. Try until you succeed. Thank you.
Any questions? Well, thank you for the presentation. And now I have two questions. The first one, are you going to focus only on Lithuanian startups?
Yes, for this 2014, we want to have a portfolio of 10 Lithuanian startups with a worldwide project vision and so on and so on. Afterwards, we have plans to expand to other markets. So this first year for us is also a validation of our model and you know, some refinements of our model, and then we go to other countries.
Trends, in your opinion, for 2014 and the upcoming years in startups? Like, in which fields they are going to focus mostly? Or venture capitalists, in which fields? Is it like gaming, biotech, or etc.?
Look, I actually think it's too hard to list all of them. I must say I'm overwhelmed with all the reviews, all the research that I'm doing of the interesting areas where to invest. You know, you can think of usual suspects. All internet projects are obviously big. Some specific projects like that fall in the category of sharing economy, like Mano Drabužiai, like Delinuose LT. This is why we invested. We think it's a very growing market. You know, 3D printing, for example, all projects around this concept, it's growing. You can expect a 3D printer in maybe 2, 3, or 4 years to be on every desk, at home, at school, everywhere. So I think this is an interesting area, but it's really too hard to list them. I think do your own research. Feel where your passion is, where you think you see the business opportunity that you feel comfortable with. Do some research, and I think you will find a niche in very many areas. So I wouldn't just, you know, name a number of these opportunities.
Hi, of course, thank you for your presentation. I guess Nextury invests, first of all, or only in startups that can show high growth and the market potential, am I right?
Yes.
Can you now be a little bit more specific? What are you looking for? What are the criteria that startups can say, well, I have it, I have these qualities or criteria, so I can maybe engage with you or contact you?
Okay. So first of all, we believe
we believe in business models where we can engage with a lot of consumers. We believe in monetization models which are not based on, you know, developing and investing into a system which you can afterwards, you know, sell to other businesses. So all consumer-focused projects are in our radar screen. What falls out of that, at least for now, we said, no, we will not focus on this. We have this experience of consumer engagement. This is where we will go. If it's something around games, that's also interesting. For example, we really look where we have competences or we can quickly access the necessary competences through our advisors and others, and we will go into these projects. So deliberately, while we have some list of specific areas we are looking for projects, we didn't announce them, just saying that let's leave it open. Maybe there's something we overlooked and we welcome all ideas. We don't have a very specific requirements or anything how you should approach us, because you know, by setting those requirements, we will limit the number of people who would be willing to approach us. So we're very open. We're looking at every idea, responding to every idea by saying, look, sounds interesting, let's talk, or just saying, look, no, sorry, it's probably a good idea, but we just don't know, and because we don't know, we will not engage.
Just to have a good idea, or you want to see something done already?
We are looking at very early stage. As early, the earlier stage, the better. So basically, you can come up with the idea saying, I haven't done anything, but I thought this through, and I believe this is how it should work. Now, if you do that, of course, we'll kind of continue the conversation and see whether you really thought things through. If so, the discussion will be longer, but if it's a good idea, very likely we'll engage and we'll help you build a team, we'll help you really to start from scratch. Why? Because I think the earlier you start, the more impact, let's say, we can have on shaping the vision together. And once we agree on that vision, we don't have to change the course, we just go where we decided to go.
Okay, and now let's talk about the planning and starting. So how we can apply to Nextury Ventures?
Like I said, I mean, we don't require Excel calculations or anything. Come up with the idea and with the description, what kind of need it addresses, what product it produces. You don't have to write immediately about monetization, but we'll definitely talk about that before we make any further step.
Yeah, so, but I just checked out your website.
Yeah.
And there is no contacts there.
Yes, there is. There is email address.
That's
fine.
Yeah.
So you have email address, right, you can write to us, and right, that's it. That's right. as simple as that. No questionnaires to fill, no specifics, nothing. Just write free format. Actually, if you can make it three sentences, the better. Because long letters, they wait for the weekend, and sometimes, you know, they fall through the weekend, and that's it. But short letters are easy to read.
So you're doing just seed funding, yes? Or you're going to Series A or...
Seed, but I mean, since we are at the seed phase, it's in our interest to walk through with you together until Series A, B, you know, until at a certain point we gradually disappear, and you as a founder, if you want, you continue. What do you think about spin-offs? Oh, here. That's good idea. I would even say we are working with some spin-offs. Yeah.
So what would a potential deal look like if I come to
Depends on, you know, whether you come with the company that already exists, that already has a shareholder structure. That's one discussion, how we can enter. Now, if you come with a good idea and you say, let's start from scratch, that's a totally different discussion. So we're willing to put money in. We're willing to, engage you and hook you as a founder who has motivation, but also who has commitment to, you know, either to actually make this project a success. So Eddie was talking about options a little bit. We believe strongly in options, that it's one of the best ways to motivate founders. And we're very willing to work with founders who, you know, come without the, how should I put it right? I mean, we don't expect founders to come up with their own investment, right? We can fund the startup from just nothing. So we'll provide you funding, and we expect you to become a shareholder at some point, which is pre-agreed. Look, what we have done so far was, let's say, between 100,000 liters and right now 500,000 from the existing projects. That was the starting phase. Some of them have advanced further with our own funding, but the idea is that we want to attract also, and we partner, like in the Cheap Data case, right? We have already attracted Practica Capital, which is a Lithuanian venture capital fund. And we're working now with other investors to attract them to this deal. So our idea is we help you start soon. We help you to find for yourself the best direction, the fastest way to your success. So don't take it wrong. We stay closely involved with managing the project, but founders have the full freedom to do, how they see it best fit for their business.
Thank you, Mindaugas. Thanks very much. It was an amazing presentation. Just some final remarks for you guys. If you feel that you have a startup or you have a startup idea, but you are not yet ready to go to the investors, you should go to Enterprise Lithuania. Or you should visit our website, which is called startuplithuania.lt. What we do there, we provide various services which are free of charge for those who want to become startups, who want to start their own business, or who are already a startup and need some help, need some professional advice. And one of the particular service what I would like to address tonight is the Startup Nitro voucher. So it's a bunch of professional consultations, everything what is needed for you to begin, and it's free of charge. So please approach us, find us online, find us on Facebook, on Enterprise Lithuania website, Startup Lithuania website, and also follow the news. We are organizing quite a lot of different events. One of the biggest upcoming event will be the Startup Fair during the Login Conference. All of you have heard of the Login Conference. If you are coming to the conference, you are free also to enter and come to the conference, which will be specifically designed for startups. You're gonna see the Lithuanian startups. You're gonna see a bunch of wonderful speakers who are gonna deliver speeches on startups, and we're gonna all meet there. I hope so. Thanks everybody for coming. Thanks once again for ISM University for providing this nice venue, and I will be very happy to see you again on the upcoming events.